But before considering the order of business, let me take this opportunity to congratulate the plurinational state of Bolivia on its 189 years of independence, as well as Jamaica on its 52 years of independence. Excellencies, we join in celebration with you and your government and peoples as you commemorate this historic day. I now wish to present a draft order of business, document CP/OD.1982/14 for consideration. If there are no objections to the order of business as proposed, we shall proceed to adopt it. Adopted. Before proceeding to the next item on the order of business, let me first remind representatives that in accordance with Article 46 of the Rules of Procedures of the Permanent Council, and I quote, "Statements by members of the Permanent Council and officials participating in its meetings shall, in each case, be limited to 10 minutes, unless the Council considers that a prudent extension of the time period is necessary." Therefore, in order to conduct this session within the time frame allotted, I would respectfully request that delegates limit their statements to a maximum of 10 minutes. At this time, we will proceed to the second order of business, and let me welcome the Minister of Planning and Sustainable Development of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, Senator the Honorable Dr. Boeing Dradrata Tiwari, if I pronounce it right properly, who is the Chair pro tempore 2013-2014 of the ACF. As we all know, the America's Competitiveness Forum is an annual event that brings together private sector and government leaders from the region to share best practices for enhancing the competitiveness, innovation, and prosperity of the region. This year, the theme for the forum is the human imagination at work, driving competitiveness, powering innovation. And today, we have the honor of the presence of the Minister, Minister Tiwari of Trinidad and Tobago, to give us a report on this. Minister, let me welcome you and offer you the floor. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, Deputy Secretary General, and all other members at the head table, and all of you members represented here today from the countries of the Americas. Let me say what a pleasure it is to enjoy your hospitality, to give an overview of how preparations are going for the America's Competitiveness Forum, which takes place from the 8th to the 10th of October this year in Port of Spain, Trinidad. I want to thank you for the opportunity to be able to present, and I hope that you will engage me in a discussion afterwards so that I can clarify any issues you may wish to have clarified. Let me begin by saying good morning and a pleasant day to each and every one of you. The America's Competitiveness Forum is a forum that has brought together the countries of the Americas to focus on issues such as competitiveness and innovation for the last decade or so. And the eighth session is going to take place in Trinidad and Tobago. The session before that took place in Panama, and the following two sessions in 2015 and 2016 will take place in Guatemala and in Mexico, respectively. The forum is a very important forum because it gives representatives of government an opportunity to engage each other on matters of common interest in the Americas. It gives business leaders the opportunity not just to interact and to interface, but actually to create business opportunities. And more than that, it gives academics and NGOs an opportunity to lend their own perspectives on the big issues of the day. The chair indicated to you that the theme of this conference is the human imagination at work, driving competitiveness, powering innovation. And I want to give you an idea of why we chose this theme, because it's important, and how this fits into the paradigm of development as we meet the challenges of sustainable development in the world, all of our countries one by one. I think most of our countries are focused on development that is broader than simply economic development. Economic development is important, but we recognize development as being more than economic development alone. And so for most of our countries, the agenda is one of sustainable development, where we balance the issues of economic growth and prosperity with environmental considerations and ecological considerations, and also socio-cultural considerations, and with a view to social capital building in our countries. And the question is, if we are to pursue a path of sustainable development, how could such development that is sustainable be guaranteed? And in a world in which there are no guarantees, we might hazard a guess that the only way we can achieve sustainable development is if we are capable of generating perpetual innovation. And if we then concede that in order to achieve sustainable development, we must be capable of perpetual innovation, the question arises, how do you make perpetual innovation possible in order to facilitate sustainable development? And when you ask that question, you realize that the only source of perpetual innovation is human imaginative capacity. The human being, the imaginative capacity of the human being, the individual citizen in our country, the ordinary citizen of the country, regardless of rank, regardless of education, regardless of socioeconomic status, each one of our people, each one of our citizens has that imaginative capacity which is God-given. And the ability to use the imagination for good and for impact and for making a difference is not dependent on the level of education someone has attained, because it is possible to be innovative if you have done a PhD or an MBA, but it's also possible to be innovative and to tap your imaginative capability if you have had very little schooling at all. For instance, the steel drum discarded by the oil industry in Trinidad and Tobago was turned into a significant musical instrument called the steel pan, and orchestras were created with steel drums, and that has evolved into things like pan jazz, like coupling the sitar and the pan, etc. And these were done by ordinary people, not people who had been schooled for any purpose. The second thing is that the human imaginative capacity does not depend on socioeconomic status or wealth. It is possible for a person in a wealthy household to use their imagination to create something that makes a difference in the world. But it is also possible for someone from a barrio to also use his or her imagination in order to create something. And therefore, the human imagination as the center of the principle of the human being being at the center of development is an all-inclusive principle which recognizes that this human imaginative capacity is innate, broadly spread, belongs to each of us, and tapping the human imagination is the key to unleashing the innovative potential of our countries. So this is the context in which we have developed the theme. And that theme we are using to drive the program. And I want to share with you, there is a presentation that is available for you to see. I will not read the presentation. You can read the things on the screen, the items on the screen, just as well as I can. And therefore, I will speak to some of the issues there. Here we have the objectives of the 8th ACF, which has to do with the political, economic, trade, investment, and development related issues. And of course, at the center of it all, competitiveness and innovation. This is the target audience, which is a full range of people from different sectors in the 34 member countries of the OAS. And basically, it brings business and government and academia together in a meaningful way. And all of us are aware that this mix of business, government, and academia has been seen as critical for science and technology driving innovation and creativity in our societies. I have a slide here on why you should be part of the ACF. Well, I will say because it's very rich intellectually. Secondly, it gives you an opportunity to engage ideas of competitiveness in a way that it has not been engaged so far up to now. By introducing the human imaginative aspect of competitiveness and innovation, I think we have brought the human dimension of competitiveness and innovation to the forefront. And we have also raised the question by doing that, what is the form of educational system and structure that we might create in order to ensure that the supply of imaginative capability from our citizens is at its most intense and creative? Because at the center of that question of the human imagination is the structure and nature of the education systems, both formal and informal. We have some distinctive elements in our ACF in Port of Spain in October that are a little different from what has been done before. For instance, the first day is going to be dedicated to the private sector. And we have a number of speakers there, and we have a number of applied workshops that will make a difference to individual businesses owned and managed by the people who are part of that particular forum. Then we have a number of business-to-business meetings and business-to-government meetings, which we have designed the program to be able to arrange. We have keynote speakers. We have a diverse range of panel discussion, about six of them. And as you will see, we have about 40 or 50 speakers from across the world and across the Americas. The private sector day is going to be built around the acronym SPICY, an appropriate name for something taking place in a place like Trinidad and Tobago and in the Caribbean. And these, of course, are the areas we're going to focus on that gives rise to the acronym. Go ahead. From the private sector forum, I think there are lots of tangibles to be taken away, many intangibles, but very meaningful tangibles. So for instance, the first segment focuses on what can business do for itself. People talk about what government can do to facilitate business, but what can business do for itself? The second segment is how to stimulate and proliferate entrepreneurs, entrepreneurship, and new business creation. I think all of us are aware that the nature and the pace of change and the driving power of technology is creating what Schumpeter has described as creative destruction. But I think all of us know from 2008, 2009, and the crisis at that time, that societies, countries can ill afford creative destruction if the creative destruction will have huge social impacts on the society. So basically, the proliferation of entrepreneurship, entrepreneurs, and new businesses, new business creation, are critical for what you might call creative disruption. Because disruption is tolerable, but destruction is very hard to carry. And therefore, again, the paradigm of how we think about the management and evolution of business in a competitive and innovative world is beginning to change. The third segment is how do we strengthen small and medium enterprises and facilitate their growth? I think in all of our countries, small and medium enterprises are perhaps the major growth sector and the broadest base of business enterprises in our country, and therefore we pay in particular attention to that. And the fourth segment, how can you harness your imagination to drive the success of your company? Well, that is very important, because if you are going to use your imagination and apply your imagination to business development and business success, it means going beyond the imaginative boundaries that business management has conditioned up to now. It means not just thinking outside the box. It means creating boxes that are porous in their boundaries and that are pliable in their boundaries, that are not fixed in their limitations by the boundaries. And therefore, this entire focus in the business day, in the business forum, is going to be on the application of the human imagination to conquer space not yet conquered so far in business creativity and business innovation. And these are some of the speakers who will be speaking there: Gabor, George Burt, Daniel Levine, Peter Sage, and each one of them will not only be speaking but conducting a workshop. Then we are going to have the America's Business Dialogue. This is another private sector element of it. We are working together with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. We are working together with ACLA, the American Chambers of Commerce, and we are working with the various national business organizations across the Americas in the individual countries and regional integrated business organizations across the region in order to create the opportunity for the America's Business Dialogue and the dovetailing with the Business Forum. And the idea behind this is that there is a summit of the Americas to come, and the issues that need to be thought through and what these issues might be in the summit of the Americas, it is important for countries to participate in the process and not have the agenda set for them from outside. So this could be an opportunity for making of the agenda and for predetermining what are the terms of engagement to move to a summit of the Americas. The IDB is going to launch Invest Americas at the forum, and this is, of course, a network for bringing investment to the countries of the Americas and creating the conditions in which investment can proliferate, because at the end of the day, capital formation is important, and part of that is by investment from outside, and part of that is by entrepreneurial initiatives and investment from inside. So this the Invest Americas Forum is very important. And IDB launched Connect Americas in Bahia, Brazil, some months ago, and we are using Connect Americas as a means of creating business partnerships before people get to Port of Spain, Trinidad, in October. So as you register, we can connect you and create the conditions for discussion on the ground, so to speak, in Port of Spain. This is the format of the forum, a full day on October 8th. So you have concurrent business sessions and governmental sessions. You have a range of panel discussions, six of them: financing, business, investment and growth, energy competitiveness and innovation, creativity, innovation, research and application, breakthrough innovations and the new generation, services industry as a driver of innovation, and innovation in education. And these are some of the confirmed speakers. We have many more speakers, but we are only presenting to you here those who have already confirmed. So I won't tell you who they are, but you can look at them and see the broad range of speakers that we have at the forum. Go ahead. Of course, the forum would be dominantly bilingual, English and Spanish, with provisions made, of course, for other languages. For instance, we have one French speaker who is going to speak, and he has elected to speak in French, and therefore we will have the translation services for that. These are the confirmed speakers. The two people below are the leaders of the two largest conglomerates in Trinidad and Tobago, and most of the speakers that you saw are international speakers from the Caribbean region, from Central and South America, and from North America, and we even have some from Singapore and India. These are the target markets that we are seeking to tap in order to bring attendance. And in speaking to you this morning, honorable members, ambassadors of your countries, representatives of your countries, I make a special appeal to you to help me and help Trinidad and Tobago and REAC, which some of your countries belong, some of the countries represented here belong to make this a genuine success in a very transformative and appealing and meaningful way by ensuring that we have the appropriate level of governmental and private sector and academic and NGO attendance. And we would be very, very grateful for your help and support. This would not make any sense to you now because it really tries to show the area in which most of the activities are clustered for convenience. This is the process of registration and accreditation. It would be nice if you would register in advance and we can have the kind of attendance and participation that would make this a success, because people are make all the difference in the world. And I want to say a special thanks in my presentation here today to the Organization of American States, the Secretary General and his office, the Assistant Secretary General and his entire staff and office, and the team at the OAS who have been real partners and have been very helpful, the members of REAC who came to Port of Spain recently, and we had a meeting there that was intellectually very rich. It had been a long time since I spent a day in which I was so engaged at the level of the mind on things that were really meaningful in terms of focus and in terms of the potential for meaningful decision making, and I want to thank them. And that meeting was followed by a meeting in Uruguay at which my own permanent secretary went to represent myself and to represent Trinidad and Tobago together with all the REAC members in Uruguay. Then I want to thank all of you, the member states of the OAS, because you are the membership of both REAC and the ACF, and it is in that context that I ask for your support and your cooperation. One of the things that I need your help with is to ensure that your ministers of trade or economy or planning or the equivalent, because it varies from country to country, the ministers who are responsible for trade, investment, and development. I would be grateful for the attendance of these ministers, which would make the political side of it very strong as we try to get the business leaders from the region to come. I want to also thank the OAS Canada Cooperation Plan, which has done so much to make this possible. The IDB, of course, who has been a partner in this enterprise, just like the OAS, and the Development Bank of Latin America, better known as CAF, who has been a major sponsor of this event, and of course ACLA, the American, I think it's American Community Confederation of Chambers of American Chambers of Commerce of Latin America, who have also been very involved in this. There are also national organizations and regional organizations, both in Central America, Latin America, in Brazil, in Colombia, in Argentina, etc., who have been collaborating with us. And we want to thank all of them for making it possible to get this far. In closing, I want to take maybe 2 minutes to give you a broad picture on the development paradigm. I raised the issue of sustainable development and the context of how the human imagination fits in a world which requires perpetual innovation to make sustainable development possible. But I want to say something, and before I do that, I want to congratulate the Plurinational Republic of Bolivia on their 189th anniversary of independence. That is a significant achievement. I had the opportunity to attend the G77 meeting recently in Bolivia, and I represented the Honorable Prime Minister, who was not able to go. And I must say I was very, very impressed, not only with the organization of the event, but with the level of engagement of the people of Bolivia. When I walked through the squares outside of the conference to talk to people, I mean, it was a truly awakening set of moments, and I found it very touching indeed to be there. And I want to congratulate, of course, our sister in the Caribbean, Jamaica, who celebrated their 52nd anniversary. And Jamaica's independence is in the same month of August as Trinidad and Tobago's independence. So later in the month, we will also celebrate our 52nd. And I do want to congratulate Jamaica on their tremendous contribution to the world in so many areas, but especially in terms of innovation in tourism and also in the area of music, which has really rocked the musical planet, so to speak. But the issue I want to close on is that many of our countries are caught in a kind of achievement trap in which our per capita income is growing, we have growth in the economy, but that we somehow cannot make the leap forward to double our per capita income or double our GDP, or to make the leap that would connect us competitively with the rest of the world. And it seems very, very difficult and very hard to do. And if that is the challenge, I think we need to admit that there needs to be a different way of approaching this business of development if we are to make those quantum leaps. And those are some of the issues that are going to be addressed at the forum in Trinidad and Tobago, and the issues that are going to come up there. And I feel that it will be a very, very important intellectual, emotional, and ideas exchange opportunity for people. And for this reason, I want to say it's a very important forum. And secondly, I want to say to you that if you've been to Trinidad and Tobago, you know that it's a beautiful place besides the event itself, and I would ask you to come again. But if you've not been to Trinidad and Tobago, I want to say that it is a place that will open their arms to welcome you. It is intellectually exciting, it is culturally exciting, and it is environmentally and ecologically extremely appealing. And besides the work of the conference, there is a lot to do. And I want to take this opportunity from the bottom of my heart, on behalf of the government and people of Trinidad and Tobago, to invite you to Port of Spain on October 8th to 10th. Thank you so much to each and every one of you. There is a video that we're going to show. It's going to take 1 minute, and it is a video spoken to about Trinidad and Tobago by our Honorable Prime Minister, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa. And it really is an invitation to you. It's an invitation that she issued in Panama when the handover took place for responsibility for the ACF from Panama to Trinidad and Tobago. It's just 1 minute.
More than things, we are interested in people. That is really any country's greatest asset. In investment terms, we call this human capital. But I prefer to call it the nation. That's some of our greatness, of our minds, and of our hands. People imagine. People build. The single most important factor in Trinidad and Tobago's performance as a nation is not that we harness and share the energy beneath us in ways that are becoming the global standard, nor is it that we've used that advantage to grow our downstream sector, though all of that is true. Things that make us unique as a nation include our location as a regional shipping hub and safe anchorage during the hurricane season, our robust and competitive ICT backbone, our increasingly sustainable agribusiness sector, an overwhelming abundance of flora, fauna, and a renewed focus on sustainability. A dynamic, connected twin island republic. A manufacturing sector which punches well above its weight. A comprehensive, holistic, and accessible education system. And a vibrant, creative industry which has delighted the senses of millions worldwide. Whilst all of these things are true, they pale in comparison to our greatest asset, people, our diversity of people in particular. We are unparalleled in this regard, given our size. Trinidad and Tobago welcomes you as the first English-speaking Caribbean country to host America's Competitiveness Forum. We see this as an opportunity to get you to know us firsthand, and through Trinidad and Tobago, to connect the entire Caribbean region within our hemisphere. Latin American friends and neighbors, let us build strategic economic partnerships to do more business with each other. The essence of competitiveness is something that you will find here in abundance, which inspires so many around the world to imagine with us.
Thank you, Honorable Minister, for this very comprehensive presentation on the preparations and logistics for the 8th America's Competitiveness Forum, as well as the information on the depth of thought and dialogue that's expected at that forum. We will certainly take a recommendation that the ideas coming out of this forum couldn't come at a better time, as we could well use them in predetermining the terms of engagement as we recommended for the next summit. You have also presented an excellent slate of speakers, and I am sure that it will lead the dialogue effectively and will give many of the participants not only food for thought, they will not only be thinking, but when they leave the forum, I'm sure they will be implementing some of the recommendations that arose out of that forum. At this time, I'd like to open the floor to delegations. I will allow everybody to speak, and then afterwards give the floor to the minister so that he would answer or respond to questions and or comments. Now I give the floor to the representative of Antigua and Barbuda. You have the sermon. You have the floor, ma'am.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, on behalf of the member states of CARICOM, I would like to thank Senator the Honorable Bo Tiwari, Minister of Planning and Sustainable Development of Trinidad and Tobago, for his presentation on the 8th America's Competitiveness Forum that is due to be held in the sister CARICOM country of Trinidad and Tobago from October 8th to 10th, 2014. The identification of the theme of the forum, the human imagination at work, driving competitiveness, powering innovation, places people at the center of this development paradigm and underscores the imperative that the application of human imagination is the source of all competitiveness and innovation. May we take the opportunity to congratulate you, sir, for putting together an exceptional program that brings a refreshing approach to the concept of competitiveness. In this regard, you have organized a stellar array of speakers who hail not only from Latin America and the Caribbean, but indeed from the wider international community. Each speaker is an expert or a pioneer in his or her own right, and would certainly bring a wealth of experience to the forum. Madam Chair, this forum comes at a time when the Conference of Heads of Government of the Caribbean Community that was convened in Antigua and Barbuda a mere 4 weeks ago approved the 5-year strategic plan of CARICOM. Paying close attention to the objective of sustainable economic growth and development, the strategic plan accords priority to the theme of building competitiveness in order to unleash the key economic drivers to transition to growth and to generate employment. In this regard, Madam Chair, the objectives of the 8th Americas Competitiveness Forum, as outlined this morning, complements the work which is currently being undertaken by CARICOM. Madam Chair, as we engage in discussions on the spicy sections, and as we create new boxes that are porous and transferable, we are confident that the ACF will inspire programs, policies, and partnerships that will improve economic prosperity at the local, regional, and international levels to ensure a brighter future for all the citizens of the region. Thank you, Madam Chair. But before I cede the floor, it would be remiss of this delegation if we did not say congratulations to Bolivia and Jamaica on their independence, and to Trinidad and Tobago when that day arrives. Thank you, Madam Chair.
thank you, Ambassador Lovell. I now give the floor to Ambassador of Belize.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Good morning, Minister. Welcome to the Permanent Council. Madam Chair, allow me to begin by also joining my voice of congratulations to my alphabetic neighbor, the distinguished Ambassador of Bolivia, and to my CARICOM brother, the Ambassador of Jamaica, both of whom are celebrating their national independence. Madam Chair, I want to thank Minister Botewari for his excellent presentation this morning and for the fantastic video that has been shown making Trinidad seem so interesting and so appealing and getting me to try to think of ways that I can convince my government to allow me to join the delegation. I don't know if that will be possible. But I am pleased this morning to take the floor on behalf of the countries of Central America to thank the Minister for his presentation. We were fortunate to get a preview of the presentation yesterday in a smaller session with the Minister. We want to especially to thank the Minister for his efforts to keep this Council informed as the preparation continues, so we get the opportunity to have an input into the greater planning, the bigger concepts. Not that there is anything lacking, but the opportunity to contribute to ensure that we have a very successful event is most welcome. Madam Chair, at a time when we need to capitalize on the imagination of our people, especially our young people, to come together, to become innovative, to show their creativity, to resolve the big problems that are confronting our countries, an event such as the Americas Competitiveness Forum is more than welcome. I think it is necessary. These days, all of our countries, all of our regions, the sub-regional organizations are talking about innovation, about creativity, about finding new ways to deal with our problems. And I think that the organization and the planning that's going into this will certainly provide an excellent opportunity for us to start thinking on how we will alleviate poverty in our countries, how we will deal with climate change, how we will generate more employment, how will we generate more economic activities, and everybody's imagination and creativity has to be taken into consideration for the good of our regions. Thank you, Madam Chair. Welcome, Minister, and thank you once again.
Thank you, Ambassador Mendez. I now give the floor to the representative of Panama. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Good morning to all. First of all, my apologies of taking the floor again, since Ambassador Belis already addressed in the name of SICA. Concerning Panama, was the previous host, we would like to take the floor also to express our congratulations to the Minister of Planning and Sustainable Development of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, Senator Tiwari, for her comprehensive presentation. As His Excellency mentioned, Panama was the previous host of the forum, and we are very pleased with the excellent planning Trinidad and Tobago already have done. We are sure that the ACF will be a successful event for the benefit of the region, and indeed Panama will look forward for the important inputs of the ACF for the Summit of the Americas. We take this opportunity to renew our biggest support to the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago as the host of the ACF, the REAC, and the Pathway to Prosperity events in October this year. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Representative. I now give the floor to the Representative of Colombia.
Muchas gracias, señora Presidenta. Primero que todo, también deseo asociarme a las felicitaciones que se han expresado por el Día de la Independencia, tanto para nuestra hermana República de Bolivia como para un país cercano y amigo como es Jamaica. En segundo lugar, señora Presidenta, quería agradecer muy, muy especialmente al señor Ministro de Trinidad y Tobago por la presentación que ha hecho, no solamente por lo completa y sin lugar a dudas, porque auguramos el mejor éxito en la realización de este evento en Trinidad y Tobago, del octavo foro de competitividad, sino porque, tal y como lo mencionara el distinguido delegado de Panamá, Colombia también tuvo la oportunidad de ser sede del sexto foro en la ciudad de Cali, que fue inaugurado por el presidente Juan Manuel Santos y un grupo de ministros. Y la verdad, ya tuvimos la oportunidad de conocer de primera mano la relevancia que tiene el tema de la competitividad, el tema de la innovación y el tema del emprendimiento. Por eso sabemos la importancia que tiene la realización del evento, en este caso específico, en un país del Caribe, como es Trinidad y Tobago, y que tiene todas las condiciones para llevarlo a cabo. Y también queremos resaltar el apoyo que da el equipo técnico de la Secretaría General a través de la Secretaría de Desarrollo. En ese sentido, señora Presidenta, vale la pena también resaltar el apoyo que le viene dando de tiempo atrás, no solamente el Banco Interamericano de Desarrollo, sino como lo resaltó el ministro, CAF, el Banco de Desarrollo de América Latina, que se ha involucrado muy directamente con estos temas y creo que es importante resaltarlo. Muchas gracias, señora Presidenta.
Thank you. Representative of Peru, Colombia. I now give the floor to the representative of Peru.
Muchas gracias, señora Presidenta. También mis primeras palabras para felicitar a los pueblos hermanos de Bolivia y de Jamaica que celebran los días nacionales respectivos. Señora Presidenta, también mi intervención es para agradecer la elocuente y estimulante presentación que hace el Ministro de Planificación y Senador Tiwari de Trinidad y Tobago. Creo que resalta un punto en la región, no solo ya existe la conciencia de que la inversión en capital humano es la única forma de dar el salto cualitativo para mejorar nuestra posición en la economía global y que la búsqueda de la competitividad es la regla de juego del sistema económico actual. Esta entusiasta y decidida iniciativa de su país le da continuidad a un foro, como dijo el distinguido delegado de Colombia, que ya se inició hace unos años en la región. Quisiéramos destacar la importancia de él, su validez como punto de contacto entre el sector empresarial y el sector gubernamental. Eso es ideal para el desarrollo y el movimiento de procesos de integración y cooperación económica. Y, señor senador, estamos, le ofrecemos la colaboración de nuestro gobierno para que haya una participación de nuestro de la delegación peruana en su evento. Muchas gracias, señora presidenta, senador Tewari. Gracias.
Thank you, Ambassador. I now give the floor to the representative of Mexico.
Gracias, presidenta. La delegación de México saluda al ministro Tewari de Trinidad y Tobago y desea agradecerle por acompañarnos en esta sesión para presentar a los miembros del Consejo los preparativos del octavo Foro de Competitividad de las Américas 2014 y por compartirnos su visión sobre la relevancia y el potencial, así como las expectativas de este foro. México reconoce también y felicita al embajador Neil Parsan por todo su liderazgo y el trabajo que ha realizado en este proceso preparatorio, sus esfuerzos. Los conocemos y lo felicitamos, embajador, se los agradecemos. Le auguramos también un exitoso y muy fructífero encuentro en Trinidad y Tobago. Quisiera igualmente reconocer y felicitar a la Secretaría General y muy particularmente al señor César Parga por su compromiso y cotidiano esfuerzo en las actividades de la OEA encaminadas a aportar un valor agregado en favor de la competitividad y el desarrollo de nuestras sociedades. El Foro de Competitividad es una de esas iniciativas, quizá la más creativa y con mayor potencial de impacto multiplicador en nuestras sociedades, en acelerado y continuo cambio y dinamismo. La delegación de México se une también, señora presidenta, a las felicitaciones que se han expresado a los distinguidos representantes permanentes de Bolivia y de Jamaica por su Día Nacional. Gracias.
Thank you, representative. I now give the floor to the representative of the United States.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you. A little glitch in the microphone. We'd like to offer our congratulations to Bolivia and Jamaica on their Independence Day. On behalf of the United States, I'd like to express our appreciation to Minister Tewari for joining us today and providing us with all the information on preparations for this very important meeting of the Americas Competitiveness Forum. We're certain that this year's ACF will inspire programs, policies, and partnerships that improve economic and social prosperity at local, national, regional levels and help create a brighter future for the people of the region. We know with great interest that you have invited a very geographically diverse group of panelists from different sectors of the economy, and we're very hopeful that this year's forum will result in important exchanges of ideas and experiences for enhancing competitive innovation and to foster greater prosperity in the region. Finally, Mr. Minister, we want to express to you that you can count on our full support for any of the preparations that you need for this meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative. I now give the floor to the Ambassador of Bolivia.
Muchas gracias, Presidenta. Muy buenos días a todas y todos. Primero, agradecer al Ministro de Trinidad y Tobago por las congratulaciones hacia mi país por el aniversario de la independencia. Asimismo, agradecer sus importantes expresiones vertidas acerca del evento realizado en referencia al G77 más China. Asimismo, agradecer a las delegaciones que hicieron referencia al Día Nacional de Bolivia. Les agradecemos de sobremanera esta referencia. En referencia al tema que hemos conocido el día de hoy, quisiéramos agradecer al Ministro de Planificación de Trinidad y Tobago por la importante información brindada sobre el Foro de Competitividad de las Américas. Consideramos importante los esfuerzos realizados por Trinidad y Tobago a la cabeza, acá en la organización, a la cabeza del embajador Neil Parsan, que ha tenido un importante liderazgo para impulsar esta temática. Sin duda alguna necesitamos fortalecer esta temática referida a la competitividad y el foro será un espacio propicio y permitirá generar nuevas propuestas a partir del diálogo entre expertos y los estados. Muchas gracias, Presidenta.
Thank you, Ambassador. I now give the floor to the Ambassador of Jamaica.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to thank Minister Tewari for his outstanding presentation on the Forum for Partnership in the Americas this morning. Minister, I can assure you we have heard much about this forum from your ambassador person, and so we are grateful that you have been able to add to and reinforce what he has been telling us. But rarely a day does pass when Ambassador Parson does not remind us of this forum. I would also like to thank the chair, Minister Tiwari, and all the delegates who have offered congratulations to Jamaica on our 52nd year of independence. I also wish to thank the representative, the ambassador of Antigua and Barbuda, for presenting a response in relation to the competitiveness forum, which reflects Jamaica's main perspectives on this matter. Trinidad and Tobago has provided excellent literature on this matter, and we are particularly impressed with the lineup of speakers from various sectors who will be taking part. I note banks, entrepreneurs, ministers, academics, CEOs of large and small companies, and so on. Trinidad and Tobago, as a venue for this forum, provides excellent music, wonderful people, and has the blessing of energy sources in rich supply. We look on with envy in that regard. We note that the forum will feature issues relating to innovation, cross-fertilization of ideas, and small and medium enterprises, among other things. And with respect to small and medium enterprises, Minister, I was wondering if you had any thoughts that you might share with us on ways in which small and medium enterprises can be drivers of growth, particularly for small economies, which are much in need of investment and enterprise. Minister, Chair, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Son of Trinidad and Tobago.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. And let me first say welcome, Honorable Minister, to Washington. And thank you very much, Minister, for the presentation. It was very deep, very insightful, and very comprehensive in terms of what was presented. Also, thank you, delegates, for the very kind thoughts expressed to the Honorable Minister from Trinidad and Tobago, and indirectly and directly to the permanent mission of Trinidad and Tobago here in Washington, D.C. And the permanent mission of Trinidad and Tobago also wishes to associate itself with the thoughts expressed by the chair of CARICOM, the ambassador of Antigua Barbuda. Minister, let me also say thank you for sort of laying the innovative elements to this particular forum in Port of Spain. The idea of an innovation village, the idea of B2B, B2G, keynote speaker engagements, and I think the idea of a private sector day is surely welcomed by delegates in this room, as it is in keeping with the principles of discussions and dialogue we have been having along the lines of competitiveness and innovation throughout the sessions we have had. I also wish to say thank you personally to the delegation of Panama. Panama, you have laid a solid foundation on which Trinidad and Tobago was able to platform its planning on logistics for this meeting in October. And as you rightfully said, you handed a good sort of example for us to follow. But also, we are reciprocating indirectly simply because the dialogue that is going to be taking place in Port of Spain, as far as the ACF is concerned, can also lay a platform for dialogue at the Summit of the Americas that you'll be hosting in 2015. So we're looking forward to that. Minister, let me also thank you on a personal note for stating categorically that the steel pan was invented in Trinidad and Tobago. Sometimes there is a perception that the steel pan was invented in another Caribbean island that I would not name. And by the way, happy independence to Jamaica and to the permanent mission of Bolivia. Thank you for correcting that. And let me reiterate that the permanent mission of Trinidad and Tobago stands ready to support the delegations in this room with any information, dispatch that is needed, or logistics or courtesies that you wish to be extended while you're in Port of Spain. Packages were left on your table for your rumination, and we look forward to your attendance in Trinidad. You know, the minister said by acronym it is going to be spicy, but in reality, it is going to be spicy. So welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Parson. I now give the floor to the to Ambassador Ramdeen, Assistant Secretary General.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and I do not have any historical corrections to make, as Trinidad and Tobago just did. Senator, the Honorable Dr. Bundradat Tiwari, Minister of Planning and Sustainable Development of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. I just wanted to use the full acknowledgement there. Distinguished permanent representatives, distinguished observers. I take the floor very briefly to say a few things about the upcoming ACF. First of all, to thank Minister Tiwari for being present personally to not only in this meeting but in several other meetings during his visit here in Washington, D.C., to advocate not only the topic, the substantive context in which this ACF will take place, but also to personally update us on the logistical programmatic arrangements for this meeting. Trinidad and Tobago, as one of the leading economies in the Caribbean, in the Western Hemisphere, clearly as well situated to host this conference following Panama and then going on to Guatemala subsequently. Trinidad and Tobago's leadership in promoting economic development and in especially in the area of competitiveness, innovation, and creativity is well known. This will be an opportunity to highlight that resourcefulness once again. So Minister Tiwari, thank you very much for being here and addressing the member states of the Organization of American States. Within the Organization of American States, as member states may recall, we have embarked on a process of engaging with the private sector much more frequently, but also much more directly. You may recall the conversation we had with top business leaders last year with the Permanent Council on the role of the private sector in development, the issue of public-private partnership, as we furthered that discussion in the private sector forum in Paraguay recently. Clearly, the private sector plays a critical role, and in the context of sustainable development, to which the minister spoke very eloquently about the objectives, but also how to materialize that, it cannot be only governments, but there is need for that collaboration between the private sector and governments. And this, again, will be an opportunity to demonstrate in Trinidad and Tobago. Madam Chair, the hemisphere, most of the countries have made economic progress, have economic growth, have demonstrated economic growth over the past years, and still, we do have many challenges facing our people in the Americas. We spoke about education challenges, migration, the issue of crime and violence, illegal drug trafficking, and we can go on. So the question Minister Tiwari put forward this morning is a very relevant one when he spoke about that achievement gap. While we have made economic growth and we have achieved prosperity, the question is how do we bring that to the next level of economic growth and prosperity so that also the social needs of the people, as we have seen presented as challenges, can be taken care of. And this is a debate which indeed requires innovation, creativity, and boosting the competitiveness of our economies. Private sector plays a critical role in this regard, and again, the ACF and the REAG meeting in Trinidad and Tobago will be an excellent opportunity to have this debate, to further this debate, and to discuss the many challenges we face within the hemisphere, and more importantly, to talk about innovation, creativity, and competitiveness enhancement. We were very pleased, and we continue to be very pleased with the cooperation with the Technical Secretariat of the Government of Trinidad and Tobago in working towards the organization of this ACF. Our Technical Secretariat, led by Maurice Robert, Cesar Parga, and Adriana Bonilla, all of them have been very much on board in facilitating this process. The innovative approach which Trinidad and Tobago took in proposing this very interesting strategic discussion on imagination as the foundation of creativity and progress is an excellent one. So it reflects also the speakers which we see who have been invited. So we look forward to, without any doubt, to a successful meeting in Port of Spain in early October, and all who are able to attend should attend. It will be the
the prime gathering of business leaders, of government representatives, and other stakeholders in Trinidad and Tobago. And Mr. Minister, the results of this forum will undoubtedly help us in terms of policy making for innovation and for strengthening our competitiveness as economies in the Western Hemisphere. But I would hope, as you stated, that it would be transformative as well and strategic in the sense that it can feed in and it should feed into the upcoming Summit of the Americas in Panama next year, but also in the discussions at the global level when we speak about the objectives of the post-2015 Millennium Development Goals. These are all opportunities to bring the vision of this hemisphere in that sense together and to have an impact at a global level. Undoubtedly, this is a great opportunity for the hemisphere, and I thank you very much once again for your presence.
Thank you, Ambassador Ramdeen. I now offer the floor to the Honorable Minister. Minister, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Assistant General Secretary Albert Ramdeen, let me again underscore the gratitude and thanks to you personally, to Shelley Das in your office, Anne Marie, and the entire team of the OAS who have been so gracious with their time, their energy, their advice, their assistance and support in every way. And I do want to take this opportunity to thank you very sincerely and to thank your staff for the work that they have done in a very, very collaborative, creative, and enjoyable way with my own staff. I do want to take the opportunity also to recognize the tremendous work of our Ambassador of Trinidad and Tobago in Washington here. Dr. Neil Parson is really the government of Trinidad and Tobago in Washington. And we rely on him and work with him in that way. And I want to take this opportunity publicly to acknowledge his diligence and his commitment and his stick-to-itiveness and to play in the ambassadorial role in a very, very constructive and engaging way here in Washington. I do want to do that. And with you, your entire staff, because nobody works alone. And we have a good staff at the embassy, and I want to take the opportunity to thank them as well. Having done that, I do want to thank also two colleagues who are here with me and to acknowledge their presence, Ms. Beverly Khan, who is the head of the organizing secretariat for the ACF and who has really been the anchor of this entire thing for close to 2 years now, and Dr. Indrani Bichon Prasad, who is responsible for the communication side of the ACF. I want to very quickly say thank you to Antigua and Barbuda and the ambassador here for her very, very thoughtful words. This is a lady I've known for some time, a very distinguished lady. I want to thank her for her kind words and deep sentiments. And I do want to thank as well all the other representatives who have spoken, representative of Belize, whom I've come to know, representative of Colombia, Peru, Panama. And I want to say to Panama that your secretariat have been very helpful. And we have continued the collaboration over the course of the year. And in fact, I was in Panama a couple weeks ago, to work in a collaborative way with people there. The Republic of Mexico and the United States of America and, of course, Jamaica. I want to let Ambassador know from Jamaica that Minister Hilton will be featured as a speaker here at one of the luncheon meetings, and he has already agreed. And we are really trying to make this a forum in which every vital voice will get an opportunity to be part of the stimulation, I would say, of the engagement and thought processes. Ambassador from the United States of America, I want to say thank you for your offer of support and help, and we do look forward to the collaboration as well. There are some issues that were raised. I wouldn't address them here. I don't think this is the appropriate forum. But I do want to say that there is some intellectual work that is buttressing this conference that is ongoing because of the support of the IDB. We're doing a number of things that we will actually launch and publish during the forum, but two of these things would be a document focusing on creative industries in the Caribbean, and a document focusing on the marriage between science, technology, and innovation, and creativity and human imagination and innovation, because the same imagination that goes into a work of painting or a work of sculpture also goes into the process of scientific discovery. And therefore, the human imagination has that capacity to marry science and art in the creative process. And I think that we have done ourselves a tremendous disservice intellectually by divorcing the scientific process from the natural, imaginative, creative process in the arts. And that is one of the things intellectually that we are also going to explore. Madam Chair, I want to thank you sincerely for your very able chairing of this meeting and your conduct of the proceedings, and for making me feel so welcome and at home at the OAS. Thank you so much.
Thank you again, Minister Mr. Tiwari. There have been no further requests for the floor. We reiterate our gratitude to enlightening us on a number of issues that will be addressed at your forum, and we are certain that the forum will be a success, due, of course, largely to the tremendous work undertaken by you and your team, Mr. Minister. And we look forward, I'm sure all of us are looking forward to meeting you and your team in Trinidad and Tobago. Thank you again.
Look forward to welcome all of you.
We now move on to agenda item 3, election of the officers of the subsidiary organs of the Permanent Council. But before offering the floor to the distinguished representatives for nominations, I'd like to remind them that Article 15 of the Rules of Procedure of the Council establishes that the Chair and Vice Chair of the Permanent Council shall serve respectively as Chair and Vice Chair of the General Committee. Article 21 again establishes that a representative of the member state presiding over the summit process shall serve as chair of the Committee on Inter-American Summits Management and Civil Society Participation in OAS Activities, CIS. And Article 29 establishes that the terms of office of the chairs and vice chairs of these committees shall be for 1 year. We have already elected these committees. In fact, we have already ratified that part of the regulation. So today we'll be moving on to electing the chairs of the permanent committees for the Committee on Juridical and Political Affairs, that's one, the Committee on Hemispheric Security, and the Committee on Administrative and Budgetary Affairs. Let's first proceed with the election of the chair of the CAJP. I offer the floor for nominations. I offer the floor to the representative of Colombia. You have the floor, sir.
Gracias, señora presidenta. Presidenta, para la nominación de la Comisión de Asuntos Jurídicos y Políticos, que tiene, como todos sabemos, una importancia muy significativa por el tipo de actividades que lleva a cabo dentro de la organización, consideramos que hay una persona que reúne las condiciones más que requeridas para esta presidencia. Me refiero al embajador Stephen Bassiani, embajador de Jamaica, y que tiene una hoja de vida envidiable. Cuando tuve la oportunidad de repasar esta hoja de vida, al igual que lo hicimos cuando su ingreso a la organización y cuando asumió la presidencia del Consejo Permanente, nos damos cuenta de la solidez con la cual va a desarrollar los trabajos el embajador Bassiani. Tiene un doctorado y estudios con honores tanto en Oxford como en Cambridge. Fue presidente del Consejo Permanente, además de ser, como todos lo sabemos, embajador de su país, no solo ante la OEA, sino ante la Casa Blanca. Ha hecho parte del Comité Jurídico Interamericano y también de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. Tiene una importante trayectoria académica dentro de su país. Fue principal en la Norman Manley Law School de Jamaica del año 2008 al 2012. Hizo parte del Comité de Codificación de Derecho Internacional Público de Naciones Unidas. Y si estos no son méritos más que suficientes para la presidencia de la Comisión de Asuntos Jurídicos y Políticos, que precisamente se encarga de estudiar, analizar y proponer ideas al respecto, pues no veo cuál sea otra categoría distinta a las que ya cumple dentro de su capacidad y formación personal y profesional el embajador Bassiani. Durante su paso por la presidencia del Consejo Permanente, que recuerdo mucho, llegó y tuvo que asumir muy pronto, demostró con creces que sabe y tiene el don del manejo de las sesiones en la forma indicada y sobre todo de lograr consensos y fórmulas de negociación para que los temas difíciles que va a tener que enfrentar el embajador Bassiani dentro de la CAJP puedan ser llevados a buen término, y por este motivo queremos presentar su nombre a consideración del Consejo Permanente. Gracias, señora presidenta.
Thank you, representative. I now give the floor to the representative of Honduras.
Gracias, presidenta. Hoy es una oportunidad para hacer importantes reconocimientos. Primero, la inspiradora y retadora presentación del señor ministro Tewari, mostrando la belleza y nobleza de su nación y retando la imaginación de nuestra región para superar la condición humana de nuestros habitantes, reconocimiento que hago por medio del embajador Neil Parsan. Segundo, congratularnos al arribar a un aniversario más de la independencia del Estado Plurinacional de Bolivia, enmarcado en el corazón verde esmeralda montañoso de las Américas, y a Jamaica en el dorado y esplendoroso Caribe. A ambas repúblicas hermanas, la solidaridad y el deseo permanente por su felicidad y progreso de parte de la República de Honduras. Y casi en un acto conmemorativo, en tercer lugar, deseo expresar mi apoyo o secundar la propuesta para que Jamaica, en la persona del representante permanente, embajador Stephen Sivaciani, en cuya demostrada capacidad, profesionalismo y sabiduría, creemos se vería enriquecida la CAJP o Comisión de Asuntos Jurídicos y Políticos. Y de no haber otra propuesta, solicitaría fuese aprobada la nominación hecha por el distinguido representante de Colombia por aclamación.
Thank you, Ambassador. It's my pleasure to announce at this time that a permanent representative of Jamaica, Ambassador Stephen Vassiani, has been elected chair of the CAJP. We now move on to the next, or Jamaica. Sorry about that, Ambassador. I now wish to give you the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm not sure if I've broken the line of the order of the meeting, but I would just like to say very quickly that I'm grateful to the distinguished representative of Colombia, Mr. Ramirez, for nominating me, and to the distinguished ambassador of Honduras, Ambassador Rosa Bautista, for seconding the nomination, and to all of you for electing me to the position of chair of the CAJP. I would also like to express my gratitude to Ambassador Diego Parry of Bolivia, who served as a chairman immediately before my election. And also, I would like to thank Ambassador Albuja of Ecuador for his willingness to contribute substantially to the work of the CAJP. The CAJP has, within its mandate, issues relating to the Inter-American Juridical Committee, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, the Court. Its emphasis is on human rights matters and on institutional development. With respect to institutional development, there are important issues relating to corruption, public management, international law, international humanitarian law, the International Criminal Court, that will need to be considered. I will do my best to carry out the mandate of the CAJP in the interest of all countries and all regional groups. I will make myself available for consultations on ways to improve the contribution of the CAJP to the OAS, and I will appreciate your perspectives. With respect to law, legal matters, and human rights, these are all important matters in themselves, but they are also tools for development. We will work towards integrating the development mandate with the mandate relating to law and human rights. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Ambassador. I now open the floor for nominations for the chair of the Committee on Hemispheric Security. I now give the floor to the Ambassador of Trinidad and Tobago.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, the delegation of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago wishes to nominate the distinguished permanent representative of Colombia, His Excellency Andres Gonzalez Diaz, to the position of chair for the Committee on Hemispheric Security. Ambassador Andres Gonzalez Diaz is the permanent representative, as we know, of Colombia to the Organization of American States since 2012. A Liberal Party politician, he started his career in the office of the legal advisor during the presidency of Julio Cesar Turbe Ayala. He has also served as the Secretary of Education of his native department of Cundinamarca, and would later serve as governor of Cundinamarca on three separate occasions. First, from 1991 to 1992, appointed by the President Cesar Gaviria Trujillo, and popularly elected twice, from 1998 to 2001, and again from 2008 to 2012. He has also served as a Senator of Colombia, Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs, and Minister of Justice and Law of Colombia. Ambassador Gonzalez is a lawyer from Externado University with graduate studies from CNCPU, and he's married to Ines, his beautiful wife, since 1997 and has three children, Manuel, Andres, Pascual, and Alejandro. Madam Chair, distinguished colleagues, it is our hope that this nomination be accepted given the robust character, experience, and expertise of Ambassador Gonzalez and the importance of the work of the Committee on Hemispheric Security to the pillars and mandate fulfillment of the Organization of American States. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Ambassador. I now give the floor to the representative, Ambassador of Ecuador.
Buenos días, distinguida señora presidenta. Mi delegación desea apoyar la propuesta del embajador de Trinidad y Tobago de postular al excelentísimo embajador Andrés González Díaz, representante permanente de Colombia ante este organismo para asumir la presidencia de la Comisión de Seguridad Hemisférica para el periodo 2014-2015, con lo cual mi delegación solicita a la sala su elección por aclamación. Gracias.
Thank you. I now wish to congratulate the Ambassador of Colombia for having been elected as Chair of the Committee on Hemispheric Security. I now give the floor to the representative of Colombia.
Muchas gracias, señora presidenta. Perdón por tomar la palabra de nuevo. El embajador González está fuera de Washington, debió viajar ayer, en su nombre quiero agradecer muy especialmente a los dos países postulantes, al señor embajador de Trinidad y Tobago, a la distinguida representante de Ecuador y, por supuesto, a todos los países que han avalado la presidencia del embajador Andrés González para la Comisión de Seguridad Hemisférica. También al embajador Pari por la representación en el grupo regional y el apoyo que se brindó, y al embajador Méndez también en sus actuaciones. Lo único que puedo agregar es que, tal y como lo hizo el embajador Andrés González en la presidencia de la Comisión de Asuntos Jurídicos y Políticos, va a trabajar con muchísimo interés en que estos importantes temas lleguen a buen puerto para la próxima Asamblea General. Y, por supuesto, espera contar con el apoyo de las distinguidas delegaciones que asistirán a las sesiones de la Comisión de Seguridad Hemisférica. Muchas gracias, señora presidenta.
Thank you, representative. I now wish to open the floor for nominations for the CAP, chair of the CAP. I now give the floor to the Ambassador of Belize.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. My delegation is honored to nominate His Excellency Ambassador Juan Pablo Lira, permanent representative of Chile, to be the chair of the Committee on Administrative and Budgetary Matters, the CAP. Ambassador Lira is a career diplomat in the Foreign Service of Chile. He has been ambassador of his country in Peru, in Colombia, in Ecuador. He is very well known and respected. He has also been the director of protocol for President Ricardo Lagos and director of foreign policy in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Chile. Madam Chair, at a time when we're looking at a very challenging period in the life of the organization and the very complex issues that will have to be addressed in the Committee of Administrative and Budgetary Matters, the delegation of Belize believes that we need a person who is very strong and very capable and respected, and we think that the Ambassador of Chile certainly meets the profile to help us through this very complex and challenging period ahead. I reiterate that my delegation is honored to nominate him to chair the CAP. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Ambassador. I now give the floor to the Ambassador of Paraguay. You have the floor, ma'am.
Gracias, señora presidenta. En primer lugar, antes de entrar en el tema, quiero hacer referencia a tres puntitos muy puntuales. En primer lugar, ya que va a ser la única vez que pienso intervenir, felicitar al vecino pueblo de Bolivia por su 189 aniversario de independencia. En segundo término, desearle el mayor de los éxitos al gobierno de Trinidad y Tobago para el octavo foro de competitividad de las Américas a realizarse en su país y hacer llegar los pésames al compañero Juan Pablo Lira por el fallecimiento de su madre y que por eso no está con nosotros hoy. Y ahora entrando en tema, apoyar la moción realizada por Belice para la nominación del embajador Lira a el cargo de la CAP. Le va a tocar una ardua tarea atendiendo a que tenemos se va a realizar el estudio del primer presupuesto bianual y solicitar su designación por aclamación. Gracias.
Thank you, Ambassador. I'd like to congratulate the Ambassador of Chile on the election to the chair of CAP. I'd now like to give the floor to the representative of Chile.
Sí, muchas gracias, señora presidenta. Antes de hablar sobre esta elección, quisiéramos aprovechar de felicitar al hermano pueblo de Bolivia por su aniversario patrio, asimismo a Jamaica, también por esos 52 años de independencia, y desear el mejor de los éxitos para el foro de competitividad que está organizando Trinidad y Tobago. Ahora, respecto a la elección a la CAP, lamentablemente mi embajador, tal como lo señaló la distinguida delegada del Paraguay, no puede estar presente porque tuvo que viajar por un problema familiar urgente el día lunes. Sin embargo, en su nombre y en nombre de la misión, queremos agradecer a la confianza depositada por el embajador de Belice, por la embajadora de Paraguay y por todos ustedes por esta elección. Son momentos complejos que se avecinan dentro de la CAP. Tenemos que aprobar e implementar el primer presupuesto bianual, acoplarlo al trabajo de la visión estratégica, además de llevar adelante lo que es la modernización de la gestión administrativa de esta organización. Es por eso que no sé si agradecer o no, digamos, esta elección, ya que el trabajo va a ser difícil, pero sabemos que vamos a contar con el apoyo de todos ustedes para el mayor éxito de este trabajo. Y además mencionar que esto se ve más complicado debido al alto nivel que nos dejó el saliente embajador de Canadá, ya que destacó de su trabajo y quiero destacar su trabajo en la CAP, por lo tanto nos va a tocar una doble tarea, ya que vamos a tratar de hacer nuestro mejor esfuerzo para alcanzar ese nivel. Muchas gracias, señora presidenta, y gracias a todos.
Thank you, representative of Chile. Before I give the floor to the representative of Bolivia, let me also extend our sincere condolences to Ambassador Gonzalez on the passing of his mother. Our prayers and thoughts are with him at this time of the indigenous period of his bereavement. I now give the floor to the Ambassador of Bolivia.
Muchas gracias, Presidenta. También expresamos nuestra solidaridad con el embajador Lira por el fallecimiento de su señora madre. Presidenta, hice la solicitud de palabra para hacer referencia a un tema que en las dos últimas gestiones de alguna manera ha creado cierta dificultad para ponernos de acuerdo en las presidencias de las comisiones. Creo que es importante que podamos pensar para el futuro, para la próxima gestión, en algún sistema que nos permita ponernos de acuerdo para un sistema de rotación por regiones de las presidencias de las diferentes comisiones, considerando que entre los dos consejos tenemos cinco comisiones. Creo que es importante también agradecer la flexibilidad de los embajadores de Ecuador, Honduras y República Dominicana, que en este acuerdo interno han aceptado asumir la vicepresidencia, en el entendido de que en el próximo semestre estarían asumiendo la presidencia, como se hizo ya en un primer momento con la CJP cuando asumimos Panamá y Bolivia. Creo que es importante, Presidenta, que para la próxima gestión podamos pensar en un sistema mucho más ordenado y mucho más equitativo, de manera que haya una representación de todas las regiones, pero además que esa representación pueda ir siendo rotativa, quizá no entre los países, pero al menos regionalmente, que se pueda ir garantizando la rotación. Gracias, Presidenta.
Thank you, Ambassador, for your proposal. We will not discuss this proposal at this time, but it will be raised again at another Permanent Council meeting. What I could do now is to thank all the candidates for their cooperation and their willingness to have this process move forward as smoothly as possible. It was with great pleasure that I recognized the willingness of a number of colleagues in trying to ensure that not only that there is some geographical representation in the nomination of candidates for positions, but they were also willing to be quite flexible in ensuring that we move the work of the organization as quickly as possible, because there is a lot of work to be done in the committees. There are, as I must remind delegations, 3 special general assemblies to be held within this year. In fact, we don't have much time. We have about five months, so many months, to get ready for some, in fact, less than 5 months. Some members, 2 of the special sessions will be held next month. So we do have a lot of work, and it was imperative that we get this moving as quickly as possible, get the chairs elected as quickly as possible, so that they could get their work moving. And so once again, let me thank those representatives who were willing and very flexible to ensure that we are ready to work in the different committees. I also wish to congratulate the colleagues for the elections, Ambassador Vassiani, Ambassador Gonzalez, and Ambassador Lira. I am sure that your competence and experience, as well as your expertise, will guide your respective chairmanships. And on behalf of the Council, I wish you every success in these endeavors. Moving right along to agenda item 4. Report on the first Inter-American Meeting of Speakers of the Legislative Branches held in Lima, Peru on July 18, 2014. This item was included in the order of business by the request of the Permanent Mission of Peru. As we all know, the Congress of Peru and the General Secretariat of the Organization of American States signed on March 31, 2014, a supplemental memorandum of understanding to carry out the above-mentioned meeting. The main purpose of this agreement was to provide the Peruvian Congress with the technical support they had requested in order to carry out successfully this historical initiative. During that meeting, presidents, vice presidents, members, and accredited representatives of the legislative branches of the hemisphere of 26 countries, plus 8 parliaments of integration and parliamentary forums, debated several issues of great importance for the legislative institutions of the hemisphere, such as generating credibility and confidence in legislatures, transparency and accountability in parliamentary management, the role and influence of legislators in the development of policies and programs linked to development, climate change and social inclusion, as well as the participation and role of female legislators. I have no doubt that a representative of Peru would give us a very comprehensive report on this parliamentary meeting. Representative, I give you the floor, Ambassador of Peru.
Señora Presidenta, como usted bien lo recuerda, a mediados de marzo último, nuestro representante permanente, el embajador Jiménez Mayor, anunció a este Consejo la decisión del Congreso de la República de Perú de organizar, con el respaldo y asesoría técnica de la OEA, el llamado Primer Encuentro Interamericano de Presidentes de los Poderes Legislativos, evento dirigido a constituir e institucionalizar un espacio de diálogo en que se pudiesen vincular los parlamentos de las Américas a través de sus presidentes. Usted ha recordado el acuerdo interinstitucional que se celebró en marzo y que permitió esa colaboración de la Secretaría de la OEA con el Congreso de la República del Perú para llevar a cabo este evento. Las coordinaciones, intensas coordinaciones que se mantuvo con la Secretaría de la OEA, el Departamento de Sustentabilidad Democrática y Misiones Especiales de la Secretaría de Asuntos Políticos y el Congreso del Perú, finalmente el 18 de julio se llevó a cabo el encuentro con resultados, a nuestro entender, muy positivos. En el evento estuvieron representados a nivel de presidentes y vicepresidentes de sus respectivas cámaras de senadores y diputados, o a nivel de asambleas nacionales, según el caso, los siguientes estados miembros de la Organización de Estados Americanos. En Sudamérica, Argentina, Bolivia, Chile, Colombia, Paraguay, Surinam, Guyana y el Perú. De Centroamérica, Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua y Panamá. Los países del Caribe estuvieron representados por sus jefes de Congreso de Antigua y Barbuda, Belice, Haití, Jamaica, República Dominicana, Saint Kitts y Nevis, Santa Lucía y Trinidad y Tobago. De Norteamérica participó México a nivel de su presidente del Congreso. Asimismo, participaron el presidente del Senado y vicepresidente del Congreso de Diputados de España, así como los presidentes acompañaron delegaciones de Argentina, Colombia, Chile, Paraguay, Surinam, Uruguay, El Salvador, Panamá, Haití, Trinidad y Tobago, Canadá y España a sus respectivos jefes de delegación, es decir, presidentes del Congreso. Igualmente estuvieron presentes delegaciones de diversos parlamentos de integración, el Parlamento Andino, el Parlamento Centroamericano, la Unión Interparlamentaria, el FOPREL, el Parlamento Latinoamericano, Parlaaméricas, el Parlamento Amazónico, el Parlamento Indígena de las Américas y la Red Latinoamericana para la Transparencia Legislativa. En total, hubo una participación parlamentaria del más alto nivel de 26 estados miembros y 9 redes parlamentarias o foros de integración regional. Quiero recordar que el evento fue inaugurado por la vicepresidenta de la República, la congresista Marisol Espinosa. Intervinieron en la ceremonia de inauguración, pronunciando sendos discursos, el presidente del Congreso de la República del Perú, congresista Freddy Otárola, el entonces presidente del Consejo de Ministros, René Cornejo, y el secretario general de la Organización de Estados Americanos, don José Miguel Insulza. El evento fue transmitido en directo a través del webcast de la OEA hacia todos los estados miembros, mediante una conexión con el canal de televisión del Congreso de la República del Perú. Los temas que fueron tratados durante la reunión, personalidades de gran reconocimiento y prestigio internacional hicieron presentaciones principales, entre ellas la señora Laura Chinchilla Miranda, expresidenta de Costa Rica, la señora Isabel Allende Bussi, presidente del Senado de Chile, el señor Pío García Escudero Márquez, presidente del Senado de España, el señor Hernán Larraín, senador chileno, líder del Grupo de Trabajo sobre Parlamento Abierto. Asimismo, el señor Cristiano Ferri, de la Cámara de Diputados de Brasil, que entre otros presentaron interesantes ponencias sobre dos temas de gran actualidad e importancia: la transparencia y la rendición de cuentas en la gestión parlamentaria, somos parlamentos abiertos, y el Parlamento como actor clave en el
diálogo colaborativo para el desarrollo económico sostenible, el cambio climático y la inclusión social. Los insumos y reflexiones recogidas de las exposiciones antes aludidas fueron tratados en el marco de dos mesas de trabajo, una por cada tema, en la que parlamentarios asistentes intercambiaron opiniones y enriquecieron con sus aportes los enfoques sobre dichas problemáticas. Las conclusiones y acuerdos de los que arribaron los parlamentarios están recogidos en sendos documentos que hemos distribuido entre las delegaciones aquí presentes. Al finalizar la reunión, los legisladores adoptaron la Declaración de Lima, también distribuida entre las delegaciones, en la que se expresó la voluntad de constituir el Foro Interamericano de Presidentes de Parlamentos, el cual, integrado por los presidentes de los poderes legislativos, así como los máximos representantes de los parlamentos de integración y foros parlamentarios vigentes en las Américas, actuará como un mecanismo integrador y articulador, así como un ejercicio de diplomacia parlamentaria de las instituciones legislativas que contará con el acompañamiento técnico de la Organización de Estados Americanos a través de su sección de apoyo a las instituciones representativas. Cierro comillas. La delegación de Chile, gratamente para nosotros, expresó su intención de acoger la segunda reunión del Foro Interamericano de Presidentes de Parlamentos. Señora Presidenta, señores jefes de misión, solamente quiero culminar destacando la importancia y trascendencia de esta reunión, dado que después de muchos años y varios intentos frustrados, esta iniciativa logró materializarse. En este foro interamericano, los presidentes de los legislativos de los Estados miembros podrán compartir experiencias y buenas prácticas para el tratamiento de los problemas comunes que enfrentan nuestras sociedades, construir desde el ámbito interamericano un espacio de cooperación e intercambio interparlamentario a nivel de jefes de poderes legislativos de las Américas. Es un evento inédito y largamente esperado por nuestra región. Finalmente, señora Presidenta, es menester hacer un reconocimiento y agradecimiento especial al acompañamiento técnico que recibimos de la Organización, de la Secretaría de la Organización de Estados Americanos, cuya asesoría y profesionalismo hizo posible el éxito de esta reunión, en particular del equipo de la sección de apoyo a instituciones representativas del Departamento de Sustentabilidad Democrática y Misiones Especiales, en las personas de los señores Moisés Benamor y Daniel Peláez. Un especial reconocimiento al jefe de gabinete del señor secretario general, que desde un principio nos dio un apoyo intenso y que reconozca no solo el Congreso de la República, lo hecho por escrito, sino directamente por esta delegación. Muchas gracias, señora Presidenta, por darme la palabra.
Thank you, representative, for your very comprehensive but succinct report. I now give the floor to the representative of Chile.
Sí, muchas gracias, señora Presidenta. Quisiera tomar la palabra para, en primer lugar, agradecer la exposición brindada por el distinguido delegado del Perú y la excelente organización del encuentro parlamentario. Como ya lo mencionó, en este encuentro asistieron los presidentes de ambas cámaras del Parlamento chileno, la senadora y presidenta del Senado Isabel Allende, que fue invitada como oradora, donde postuló la importancia del Parlamento como actor clave en el diálogo colaborativo para el desarrollo económico sostenible. Asimismo, la necesidad de aumentar la credibilidad de los parlamentos y los parlamentarios e identificar escenarios de cooperación y coordinación para potenciar capacidades y evitar duplicidades de esfuerzo. Por su parte, también el senador chileno, tal como lo señaló el distinguido delegado del Perú, don Hernán Larraín, invitado en su calidad de presidente de la Red Parlamentaria Latinoamericana Pro Transparencia y titular de la Comisión de Ética y Transparencia, también realizó una presentación donde se refirió a la transparencia y rendición de cuentas en la gestión parlamentaria y planteó los desafíos de los poderes legislativos de las Américas, los que aseguró deben asumir en forma institucional el desarrollo del Parlamento abierto. Finalmente, destacar esta iniciativa liderada por la Misión Permanente del Perú, la cual de alguna manera viene a enriquecer los trabajos de esta organización. Muchas gracias, señora Presidenta.
Thank you, Representative. I now offer the floor to the Representative of the United States.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. My delegation would like to briefly take the floor to thank the delegation of Peru for providing this very insightful and comprehensive presentation on the first Inter-American Meeting of Presidents of the Legislative Branch recently held in Lima. We wish to take this opportunity to congratulate the government of Peru for the successful outcome of this very timely and important initiative, which we believe strengthens the OAS and its core pillars of democracy, human rights, and development, and aims to promote dialogue and cooperation among our legislatures in addressing the many pressing common issues affecting our societies and our region. We'd also like to note the dedicated work carried out by the General Secretariat and Secretary General Insulza in providing technical support to this effort. We'd further note, Madam Chair, that this initiative is consistent with and serves to advance fulfillment of the long-standing General Assembly mandates on this topic, and we commend the leadership demonstrated by the delegation of Peru in bringing it to fruition. Finally, Madam Chair, my delegation believes this initiative has great merit and promise in helping advance our shared commitment to strengthening democratic institutions, and we look forward to the follow-on efforts in Chile to build upon the outcomes of the gathering in Lima. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Representative. Since there are no further requests for the floor, I would like to thank the representative. I now offer the floor to the Venezuelan representative. You have the floor, ma'am.
Gracias, Presidenta. Buenos días a todos. Al ser la primera vez que tomo la palabra, quisiera felicitar al Estado Plurinacional de Bolivia por el aniversario de su independencia, así como a Jamaica. Bueno, cuando se firmó el memorándum de entendimiento que concerniente a esta reunión, mi delegación presentó una serie de dudas. Hoy, al leer preliminarmente el documento, también se presentan otra serie de dudas en el sentido de el papel o el carácter de la OEA en esta reunión, ¿no? Entendemos que es una especie de acompañamiento técnico, ¿no? Pero si observamos los puntos declarativos, se manifiesta la voluntad de constituir un foro interamericano de presidentes de parlamentos. O sea, no estoy clara si es simplemente la manifestación de la voluntad futura o en este documento ya se está constituyendo esta instancia y si este foro contará con el acompañamiento técnico de la OEA. O sea, no sabemos qué papel juega la OEA en este foro. O sea, como vemos que el documento está membreteado por la OEA, me imagino que tiene algún papel o carácter la participación de la organización como tal. Y por otro lado, no nos queda claro el término diplomacia parlamentaria, toda vez que constitucionalmente en mi estado no se tiene estipulada el carácter de diplomacia parlamentaria o el papel de diplomacia de los poderes legislativos. Por otro lado, no, es todo. Gracias.
Thank you, Representative. The Chair notes your concern. We're sure that this concern can be raised at CAJP for possible consideration with a view to bringing some recommendations back to the chair back to the PC for further consideration again. So a recommendation coming out of the CAJP. So this could be discussed at the CAJP level. But your concern is noted at this time. Thank you. There being no further requests for the floor, the chair wishes to thank the delegation of Peru for the excellent presentation. And we hope that this forum, in which a number of countries participated, will not just stop there, but will continue, as our parliamentarians do need to get together to share experiences and good practices. Thank you again, Representative Peru. Moving right along to agenda item 5, we need the approval of the minutes for CP/ACTA 1917/13, the regular meeting of May 1st, 2013, CP/ACTA 1925/13, the regular meeting of June 12, 2013, and CP/Acta 1926/13, the regular meeting of June 26, 2013. The Secretariat has informed me that no objections or no corrections to these minutes were proposed by delegations, and based on the information given to the Chair, we would now like to approve these minutes. If there are no objections to approving these minutes are approved. We have now reached agenda item 6, the last item on our agenda, other business. I now wish to give the floor to the Ambassador of Bolivia.
Muchas gracias, Presidenta. Nuevamente tomo la palabra para agradecer a todos los representantes de los países hermanos que se refirieron para congratular a mi país por el 189 aniversario de la independencia. Y con este motivo tenemos una celebración el día de hoy en el Salón Las Américas, así que quisiéramos invitarlos a todos a que podamos, inmediatamente termine el Consejo, podamos trasladarnos y disfrutar de una sabrosa comida boliviana y también disfrutar de un pequeño baile boliviano. En ese sentido, Presidenta, quiero también invitarla de manera especial para que pueda acompañarnos en esta celebración y esperamos que todos puedan disfrutar de este día y acompañarnos. Gracias, Presidenta.
Thank you, Representative, for your invitation. I am sure everyone will proceed to the Hall of the Americas. The next item, I now wish to give the floor to the Ambassador of Uruguay, the Representative of Uruguay.
Gracias, Presidenta. Buenos días. También saludamos a la República de Bolivia y a Jamaica por el aniversario de su independencia. Y particularmente la delegación de Uruguay desea destacar un hecho ocurrido en el día de ayer en nuestra República Hermana Argentina, es algo muy significativo para nuestras sociedades, que por eso Uruguay desea especialmente hacer mención al suceso este. Para eso voy a proceder a leer el comunicado de prensa que el Ministerio de Relaciones Exteriores ayer mismo emitió. El Gobierno de la República Oriental del Uruguay expresa su más profunda satisfacción ante la aparición de Guido, nieto de la presidenta de Abuelas de Plaza de Mayo, señora Estela de Carlota, nacido en cautiverio y desaparecido durante la última dictadura argentina. Para el Gobierno de la República Oriental del Uruguay, la recuperación de este nieto número 114 es motivo de celebración, constituye una demostración de coraje y lucha por los derechos humanos y una fuente de inspiración para continuar apostando a nuestro compromiso con el derecho a la memoria, a la verdad y a la justicia. Muchas gracias, Presidenta.
Thank you, Representative. I now wish to give the floor to the Ambassador of the representative of Ambassador of Argentina, sorry.
Gracias, señora presidenta. Agradecemos especialmente a la República de Uruguay esta mención a este hecho que tomó ayer estado público en mi país y que nos permite, al recordarlo, explicar también un poco cuál ha sido la acción en estos años de la organización, de la asociación Abuelas de Plaza de Mayo. Efectivamente, ayer mi pueblo, muy conmocionado y emocionado, celebró que Estela Carlotto, presidenta de esta organización Abuelas de Plaza de Mayo, hubiera encontrado a su nieto, al que buscó obstinadamente durante 37 años. Efectivamente, el juzgado federal la citó para notificarle los resultados del análisis del ADN de un joven que se presentó porque dudaba de su identidad y por eso se lo sometió a estos exámenes de sangre que se compararon con un banco de muestras de sangre y permitieron establecer con un 99,99% de posibilidades la compatibilidad de la sangre de este joven con la de las familias Carlotto y Montoya. La historia de Estela Carlotto, presidenta de esta organización, empezó en el año 76, cuando ante el secuestro de su marido, un dirigente gremial, que después recuperó su libertad, comprendió que la situación en la ciudad de La Plata, además capital de la provincia de Buenos Aires, y ciudad estudiantil por antonomasia, porque hay ahí una universidad muy importante a la que vienen a estudiar personas de distintas provincias de la Argentina, la represión empezaba a tener características muy alarmantes. Como su hija, Laura Carlotto era una militante política, ella le pide, por favor, más conociendo el relato de lo que había sido ese secuestro de 2 meses de su marido, en el cual fue sometido a terribles torturas, que se fuera del país. Laura Carlotto era una militante montonera, profundamente comprometida, y le dijo a su madre que de ninguna manera se iba a ir, que sabía los riesgos, que asumía la posibilidad de su muerte, que iban a morir muchos, pero que lo importante era que después iba a haber una sociedad y un país mejor. Y ese era el sentido de su lucha y estaba dispuesta a afrontar la posibilidad de su muerte. Fue imposible convencerla de lo que el instinto maternal en una primera instancia intenta, que es proteger la vida de una hija. Y efectivamente fue secuestrada un tiempo después, estando embarazada de 2 meses y medio, cosa que Estela, la hoy presidenta de Abuelas, no sabía. Recibe un mensaje de una persona que había recuperado la libertad y había estado detenida en el mismo lugar que Laura, que le dice que le avise a su madre que está embarazada y que su embarazo está bien, que le dan de comer un poco mejor, justamente por eso, porque está embarazada, y que le dicen que cuando tenga su hijo va a ser llevado a la casa cuna, un lugar donde históricamente se encarga del cuidado, la atención médica y después también la distribución posterior que determina la justicia de niños abandonados. Que estén atentos, que el nacimiento se va a producir en el mes de junio, que estén atentos a la casa cuna, porque a ella le dicen que su hijo o hija va a ir a la casa cuna. Con esa información, bueno, seguían las gestiones buscando la recuperación de Laura, hasta que en el mes de agosto, ¿sí?, 2 meses después de lo que ya habría sido el nacimiento, por supuesto que en la casa cuna no se encontraba ningún rastro de un chico que pudiera provenir de este centro clandestino de detención donde estaba Laura. La llaman para notificarla de la muerte de su hija y para entregarle el cadáver. Es uno de los casos que no estamos ante un desaparecido, sino ante una persona cuyo cadáver fue entregado a la familia. Con una enorme cantidad de impactos de bala, a pesar de que claramente, y de acuerdo al relato anterior que he hecho, estaba detenida y se formuló la explicación de que había resistido una detención y murió en el enfrentamiento. Ahí empieza entonces una batalla de Estela, que hasta ese momento era una madre de Plaza de Mayo, porque ese es el fenómeno que se dio. Las madres se convirtieron a veces después ya en abuelas, son las mismas. La organización primero estaba destinada a buscar a sus hijos con vida, pero cuando esa posibilidad desaparece, o cuando además tienen alguna noticia de que sus hijas embarazadas habían logrado parir un hijo en estos lugares de detención, empiezan a buscar a sus nietos. La verdad es que ese objetivo en ese momento, les estoy hablando del año 77, 78, parecía una locura. Porque era buscar una aguja en un pajar. Buscar un niño que no se sabía exactamente cuándo había nacido, ni dónde, ni dónde lo podrían haber derivado, ni si era varón o nena. Además había cierta incredulidad de la sociedad, que pensaba que, bueno, serían algunos casos aislados, a pesar de que las madres empezaban a registrar muchos casos de hijas embarazadas que habían parido en cautiverio. Pero la sociedad, desde una cierta racionalidad inocente, decía, bueno, puede ser que algún jefe militar de alguno de esos lugares de detención pueda haberse, en fin, apoderado de ese niño, pero bueno, es muy difícil encontrarlo porque son situaciones individuales. Difícil hasta que se entendió que no eran hechos aislados, producto de la actitud individual de algunos jefes militares. Difícil hasta que las evidencias reiteradas, importantes, demostraron, y así lo estableció la justicia, la existencia de un plan sistemático de robo de bebés urdido por la dictadura, que incluso reglamentó estas situaciones y previó la organización adecuada para que esos bebés nacieran a través de maternidades clandestinas. Yo creo que el robo de bebés es quizás la mayor demostración de inhumanidad de los genocidas. Hay que imaginarse, las mujeres además lo sentimos todavía esto con más emoción, lo que implica que a uno le arranquen, a las pocas horas de tener un hijo, le arranquen a esa criatura. Todo esto en el marco de la situación en la que además tenían familias, porque si bien las alimentaban mejor para que los chicos nacieran en buenas condiciones, Laura Carlotto, por ejemplo, tuvo su hijo encapuchada y con grillos en las manos y en los pies. Arrancarle el niño a una madre que acaba de parir es un hecho de una crueldad infinita, demostrativo además de una soberbia y una omnipotencia casi incomprensible. Sentirse dueño de un ser humano, dueño hasta el extremo de cambiarle la identidad y de definir su destino futuro. Los avances de la ciencia vinieron en ayuda de esa tarea casi imposible que se habían autoimpuesto las abuelas de Plaza de Mayo. Se organizó un banco de muestras de sangre de abuelas que registraban esta situación de que sus hijas o las esposas de sus hijos habían tenido una criatura en cautiverio, y entonces ellas dieron muestras de sangre para que pudiera hacerse ese banco de muestras que permitiera en algún momento, a medida que se presentara una situación concreta, hacer la comparación pertinente para establecer si ese menor que aparecía podía estar relacionado con alguna de estas familias. Lamentablemente, eso ya fue varios años después del comienzo de este problema, en la década del 70, y muchas abuelas ya se habían muerto porque eran muy mayores, de manera que ese banco que hoy tiene la justicia argentina es un banco incompleto. Somos conscientes de esto, pero nos ha permitido, hasta este encuentro de Guido en realidad hoy se llama Ignacio, no Guido, pero en ese mensaje que Laura Carlotto, desde su centro clandestino de extensión, a través de esa detenida que iba a recuperar la libertad,
le mandó a su madre, le dijo que iban a ser en junio y que ella le ponía, quería poner Guido como su padre. Por eso todos decimos y hablamos de Guido. Habrá que ver si Ignacio quiere finalmente cambiarse su nombre y llamarse de acá más Guido. Estos avances de la ciencia permitieron que de los 500 nietos que buscamos se hayan encontrado 114. Guido es el número 114. Esa tarea casi imposible, esa aguja en el pajar, se encontró 114 veces en la Argentina. Y a veces fue por investigaciones que pudieron hacer las madres sobre algunas denuncias que hicieron personas de situaciones que les parecían de adopciones irregulares. Y otras veces, como en el caso de Guido, fueron los mismos nietos los que se presentaron a pedir que se les hiciera la muestra de sangre porque dudaban de su identidad, por distintas circunstancias puntuales. Este es el caso de Guido. Él dudaba de su identidad y, si bien no es un militante, había tenido, sin embargo, es músico y había tenido ya alguna participación en algunos eventos de un grupo en la Argentina que se llama Teatro por la Identidad y que justamente lleva a la escena obras que están relacionadas con este tema. Y como tiene una orquesta que actúa en apoyo de sus presentaciones, bueno, Guido se había acercado para colaborar con ese grupo de teatro. Esto ha sido emocionalmente muy importante en la Argentina porque es un nieto más y festejamos mucho y sentimos mucho y nos ponemos muy contentos cada vez que encontramos un nieto, pero en este caso, es especialmente conmovedor para los que conocemos a Estela, porque ella, que con gran generosidad no solo buscaba a su nieto, sino que busca a todos los otros nietos, a todos los que faltan hasta llegar a 500 y que buscó todos estos 114, no podía concretar eso que ella decía siempre, que quiero abrazarlo antes de morirme. Y son todas personas muy mayores ya. Hoy a la mañana, yo la escuché en los noticiosos cuando salía de su casa y dijo, es además también una manera un poco de tener a Laura en casa. He recuperado ese pedazo de Laura que andaba por ahí y no sabía dónde. Es una batalla más ganada en la lucha por el derecho a la identidad. Es un logro más de las abuelas que, con una nobleza y una entereza increíbles, ayer estaba en la conferencia de prensa al lado de Estela Carlotto, otra madre, Rosa Reusenbild, con 95 años, que todavía va ahí todos los días. Ella ya recuperó a su nieto hace 6 años, pero todavía sigue yendo ahí todos los días a desarrollar esta tarea de búsqueda de los nietos de las otras abuelas, en una actitud además muy solidaria y muy ejemplificadora. Por eso aprovecho esta ocasión para rendir un homenaje a las abuelas, a su constancia, a su coraje, a su persistencia. Y es un logro más de un pueblo y una nación que decidieron, a pesar de las permanentes y activas resistencias de los genocidas y sus cómplices, transitar el camino de la verdad, la justicia, la memoria y la reparación. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Ambassador, for this very informative and quite revealing historical presentation on the fight of grandmothers in identifying lost little ones. Everyone needs to bring closure at some point to events in their lives. I'm sure this council wishes to congratulate and, of course, wish them all the success in pushing forward. and continuing the fight in identifying the lost little ones once they are found. I now wish to give the floor to the representative of Colombia.
Gracias, señora presidenta. Hoy he hablado hasta la saciedad, no tenía pensado intervenir, pero la verdad, el tema que trajo a colación la distinguida delegada de Uruguay y lo que acaba de decir la señora embajadora de Argentina nos conmueve a todos. Con la venia suya, señora presidenta, y de la señora embajadora de Argentina, encontré este escrito esta mañana en las redes sociales de la presidenta Cristina Fernández de Kirchner, seguramente escrito anoche, al calor de los acontecimientos. Es muy breve y si me permite leerlo, porque creo que conjuntamente con lo que dijo la señora embajadora de Argentina, conmueve muchísimo a todos quienes estamos aquí presentes en este recinto y creemos en el tema del respeto y la promoción de los derechos humanos como un dogma. Escribe lo siguiente la señora presidenta Fernández de Kirchner. Se acerca un secretario y me dice, encontraron al nieto de Estela. Por un instante, aunque parezca mentira, me quedo muda. Me viene a la mente la imagen de Estela ayer en la noche en La Rosada, en el acto en el Salón de las Mujeres Argentinas. Había llegado tarde y tuvieron que agregarle una silla. La saludé agitando mi mano. Esa misma noche, antes de irme, una artista, Guillermina Greenbaum, me alcanzó una obra de su autoría y me dice, tomé como imagen la de Estela Carlotto. El cuadro se llama Madre. Qué increíble, ¿no? Postergamos esa visita 3 veces y justo anoche me lo dio. Recobro el aliento y la llamo de inmediato. Ella estaba saliendo del juzgado y yo estaba llorando. Me cuenta que es músico, que vive en Olavarría y lo más importante, se sometió voluntariamente al examen de ADN. Se la nota contenta, emocionada, plena. Comillas, me estoy yendo a abuelas, allí están mis hijos y voy a dar una conferencia de prensa para informar. ¿Te das cuenta, Cristina? Comillas, claro. ¿Cómo no me voy a dar cuenta cuánto tiempo, cuánta lucha, cuánto sufrimiento? No puedo evitar recordar a Néstor. Él, un optimista reincidente, siempre me decía, vas a ver, Estela va a terminar encontrando a su nieto. No se equivocó. Siempre decíamos que más temprano que tarde sabremos más y más, no tengo dudas. Lo más importante, el conocimiento de la verdad, la persistencia de la memoria y el triunfo de la justicia en serio. Memoria, verdad y justicia, pilar fundante de esta Argentina que estamos construyendo. Hoy Estela estará por fin junto a todos sus nietos. Hoy Guido, su nieto, recuperó su verdadera identidad. Hoy por fin Laura, su madre, podrá descansar en paz. Hoy la Argentina es un país un poco más justo que ayer. Quería compartir con ustedes esas palabras. Realmente me llegaron profundo y me conmovieron. Gracias, señora presidenta.
Thank you, Representative of Colombia. There being no further requests for the floor, I now wish to thank all representatives for their cooperation in ensuring that we work within the time frame of this meeting. In fact, we have 25 minutes before 1. And we have done tremendous work, quite productive. Let me thank you again, and I will count on your cooperation the next meeting. Thank you. This meeting is adjourned.